I'm just here at Newgrange, just leaving Newgrange. It's a dull evening here in the Boyne Valley, very cloudy. What time is it? Nearly 8 p.m. But it's April and the days are getting longer and longer, and it's great. 9 degrees, so it's not the warmest either. It's been a kind of a dull couple of days, but we've had a nice spring. It's been pleasant, and we had a good winter. We didn't have a huge amount of rain. So I'm just looking down over the valley. I'm doing one of my drive along videos that I do from time to time, and lots of sheep and cattle down in the fields. It's a busy scene, and I wonder what the ancestors would make of all that if they could be here today to see how much agriculture had advanced since they introduced agricultural practices into this country. In this valley, certainly more than 5,000 years ago. Pardon me, and perhaps as much as 6,000 years ago. Anyway, the primary reason I'm making this video tonight is because the Mythical Ireland Facebook page is just on the verge, as we speak, hopefully, is just on the verge of reaching 30,000 likes. So it's been a fabulously interesting journey for me, this whole thing. It began when I was a kid with an interest in astronomy and the stars, and then in primary school, when we were getting occasional glimpses through our history or our geography lessons as to what was happening out in the valley with the excavations at the time. These huge monuments that had been excavated, Belt was still being excavated and being explored. I'm going to take the turn and go up past Douth on the way home, which is my favourite way home from Newgrange. Obviously, one of the great monuments, the others being Newgrange and Douth. Anyway, the internet has been a great thing for information and pictures and video content around the megalithic monuments and around ancient Ireland and mythology and astronomy and all that stuff. So it's been great. But the journey began in earnest for me 18 years ago when I met Richard Moore. That was January of 1999. That's when it really began in earnest, because we began exploring the valley and coming up and down regularly, visiting main sites plus a whole plethora of secondary sites and smaller monuments, and then reading a lot of literature, and it opened my mind to fantastic realms, to be honest with you. So initially, to my mind anyway, having all the practical experience of practical astronomy when I was young, as in looking at the stars, actually spending time out under the sky, being aware of the sun's movement through the year, how the moon moves through the month, how the moon moves through the year, how the moon and the planets move against the background stars, the constellations we know today as the zodiac, and having an interest in all that, it stood me in great stead when it came to looking at the astronomical function of the monuments. Because, you know, when we approached this subject initially, you know, it appeared that all of the work had been done, the experts had written all their books, the archaeologists and the anthropologists and the historians and the geographers and the geologists, and it seemed there was pretty much nothing left to write about. However, over the years it's become obvious, to me anyway, that first of all, I think the astronomical function of the monuments had been underestimated. So that's something that I wrote about in my first book, which I wrote with Richard Moore, Island of the Setting Sun in Search of Ireland's Ancient Astronomers, and went into some detail in Newgrange Monument Immortality in 2012. But then I suppose latterly, in the past number of years, the journey for me has opened up also into mystical realms, because it's difficult to approach the monuments and to behold the scale of them and the grandeur of them, and I suppose the grandeur of the landscape and the epic, and it really is epic, size of these things. and the monumental effort that was put into construction, that it's difficult to approach that without thinking that for the builders, it wasn't all about science, of course, that there must have been a sort of a deeply mystical function or a deeply spiritual, religious, I suppose, aspect to why they might have constructed these monuments. So that's been where my focus has gone in later times, while all the time sort of keeping attention on the astronomical function as well, which I think was central to their beliefs. I think that ultimately we're probably looking at a cosmological spirituality, a cosmology basically that considers everything to be connected, not just the material world and the outside world, as it were, the out there of space and the cosmos and the night sky and the stellar realms, that something that we behold, that magical scene that unfolds every night that it's clear, of course, because the climate in Ireland isn't always conducive to astronomical study. But that scene that unfurls every night, that magic and majesty of the night sky, that to me, still at this stage of my life, having steeped myself in astronomical study for years, still has an awesome and nuministic, almost, I suppose, a mystical feel to it. So yeah, we think we know what we are and what we're made of, and we know about the Earth and its position in the scale of things, and in the space of a few hundred years we've gone to believing that the Earth was at the absolute centre of the universe to knowing that it isn't, and in fact not only is it not at the centre, but it's actually on the fringes. We're a small planet orbiting a relatively mediocre star at the edge of a normal galaxy in a small cluster of galaxies. We're not center stage like we thought we once were, but the deeper and the bolder we go with space study, the bigger it becomes, the whole thing. It becomes bigger, and we consider space to be much grander in scale and enormity, beyond almost the comprehension of the human brain, because it's on such a massive scale. And I just wonder, when the ancients were building their monuments and beholding the night sky and beholding the coming of the sun in the morning and watching the travels of the moon and Venus and Jupiter and the various planets, which they obviously had different names for back then, what were they thinking about all that? Were they thinking, well, let's study the patterns of them and mark them in stone and create stone monuments that align to them, and then we'll create our calendar around that? Or were they also thinking, which I think is more likely, well, you know, that there is something here, there's a greater force or a greater set of forces at work than we can possibly comprehend, and that they wrapped up the cosmology and spirituality, or maybe didn't need to, maybe it was just inherently so. For the ancient people who lived along the shores of this river in ancient times, I have to say, I've developed a great love of the Boyne River and Valley, and I think that exploration of its myths is as equally as important as study of its monuments and their archaeology. Because let's face it, if you're looking at something that old, you can't communicate with the people that built it. There isn't, it appears, a written language. The carvings don't appear to be a language as such, but an abstraction of symbols, and a lot less representational art than one would expect if these were just purely works of art. There's an abstraction, there's a level of abstraction there that defies description. So I think that you can maybe extend that line of inquiry into, you know, the meaning and the purpose behind the monuments, that it's not something that can necessarily be just extrapolated from looking at the monuments and the archaeology and the age of things and artifacts and saying, yes, this is what they did and this is what they were. I don't think we'll ever know for sure anyway, but sure as hell I can tell you the exploration of these things is very exciting. So it's opened up onto several new planes for me, planes of exploration. And these include, as I said, the mythical and the mystical aspects. So I've spent a lot of time in the past few years close to the Boyne, and I find there is an enrapturing charisma. There's an appeal about that. The Boyne sort of draws you towards it. It's one of Ireland's great rivers, and so naturally serene and beautiful that, you know, spending time along its banks and just listening to its waters lapping by, quietly moving, this continuous internal movement of water, is very good for one's mental health and for one's soul, for one's spirit. It's a very, very wholesome experience, generally, by and large. Of course, you have to be careful in the winter time when there's been a lot of rain and there's floods and the storms. You don't want to be too close then. But you know, I can see now why anglers love so much their hobby. Even if they never catch anything, you know, they could go out and spend hours and not catch anything. But, you know, it's just that experience of being beside this mighty river. And then to comprehend or to just think about the myths and all of the very important myths and mythical happenings and historical happenings and quasi-historical happenings that are said to have taken place. I mean, I'm just about to pass underneath the Mary McAleese Boyne Valley Bridge, which carries the M1 motorway over the Boyne River just here outside Drogheda. And the funny thing is that right here is the point where William of Orange was said to have crossed the river and actually been shot at, just up here. So the whole river, from source to sea, is accompanied along its banks and throughout its meandering history by many events, mythical and historical, and a mixture thereof. Things that are said to have happened that we don't know whether they actually really did happen, and we might never know. For instance, St. Patrick arriving along the Boyne and sailing up to Slane to light the Paschal fire. Did that really happen? Well, sure, look, that's what they tell us happened. But somebody said once that the known facts about St. Patrick's life could be written on the back of a postage stamp, but his myth and folklore abounds, would fill dozens of volumes, and that's certainly true. So anyway, the latest part of the journey for me, hopefully I don't run out of space for this video before I get to say all this, but the latest journey for me has been one that's looking into the origin myths and the creation myths surrounding the Boyne Valley, which I believe is a very important aspect of, again, extrapolating all of the deeper meanings, I suppose, and perhaps that in that exploration there might be relevance for us today. I've certainly touched upon those sort of things in my work, where I've talked about the invasion myths and, you know, the continuation of the the archetype of the invasion myth in contemporary Irish political life. Anyway, not to get into it too deeply, I've been very excitedly looking at the likes of the story of the Mata, which I've mentioned in a previous car video, the slaying of the monster and the dismembering of the monster at Brunabonia at Newgrange, and the tossing of his parts into the Boyne River, and that is, in my mind, undoubtedly the remnants of a very early creation myth, probably, possibly predating the monuments, possibly again by a long period of time. We could be talking millennia. The story of the drowning of Boyne and how she approached Necton's Well and how it erupted and formed the Boyne, but carried Boyne all the way down along the river down to the sea. I believe that's a creation myth. The story of the Toynbo Cuinge, much of which is set in this area, Muirhevne, the plain which Cuchulainn was said to have called his own, which actually finishes, its southerly extreme finishes, it's marked by the Boyne River. And then to the story of Fionn Mac Cuaill and Finnegas the Wise, and how the salmon of knowledge was caught in Feick's Pool, which is along the Boyne River, and I've been looking for that exact location lately because I believe the location actually physically exists and is there to be identified. And the story of how Finn gained all the knowledge, Fionn or Finn as we might call him, gained all the knowledge. Another story that has captured me that doesn't have an immediate connection to the Boyne is the story of Fintan Mac Bochra, or you might know it in its other version, Tuan Mac Carroll, about the man who has lived for 5,000 years in various forms, survived the cataclysmic biblical flood by taking the form of a salmon and then later changing into an eagle and a hawk. And now his relationship with the Boyne, I think, is tenuous, but it's connected, no doubt, in my mind, through the fact that in one of the versions of the Salmon of Knowledge, which was caught at Rosnaree, between Rosnaree and Nowth on the Boyne River, one of the versions of the story says that the salmon had a name and that its name was Fintan, which I find absolutely fascinating. So I think that there's a huge course to be run still. I mean, if you think about this journey in terms of, the journey of a river like the Boyne, it starts off, according to mythology, in the Well of Segesh, you know, as a spring or a small well in County Kildare that feeds a tiny little stream, and that stream meets with other streams and tributaries and eventually forms a river. And the river meanders and runs up through all of the lush landscape of this part of the world, and it is very lush, and it's easy to see why somebody might try to set up the first agricultural enterprises here, because the land is so productive and so lush. And then it runs down and runs into the sea. I've just crossed over the Boyne actually here in Drogheda on the Bridge of Peace, which was so called because it connected north and south. This used to be the main Dublin-Belfast road connecting, I suppose, the Republic of Ireland with Northern Ireland. So it was called the Bridge of Peace, and it's interesting that it should cross the River Boyne. But the last few miles of the river runs from here out towards the Irish Sea, where Bowen is said to have drowned. But certainly the exploration will continue if I'm able to continue it. And it gets deeper and it gets better and it just gets more exciting. It doesn't ever seem to get to a stage where it's, you know, I'm saying, Anthony, you know, you've kind of exhausted all this stuff now. You know, you're going to have to leave it now and go on to something else. Nope. It becomes more captivating. It demands more time. It gets more exciting. There are revelations that come. There are moments of absolute bliss that happen in this. There are extraordinary synchronicities that have occurred. The latest of which was I did a short video review of the new book about the Boyne River by Tony Holton. And Tony left a message on my home phone that I didn't hear for a few weeks because I don't use the home phone. I only ever use my mobile. And in the message, he said, look, lovely review. Give us a call and we'll have a chat. Gave him a ring. And he said, you know what the strangest thing happened, Anthony? He said, I was in Slane and I saw your novella, which is Land of the Ever-Living Ones. I've written a couple of works of fiction as well. And he said, I was at home reading it, and I was no more than 10 pages into it when the phone rang, and it was my wife. And she said, Tony, you'll never believe it, but there's a lovely review of your book on the internet. And he goes, oh, that's interesting. She said, yeah, it's by a guy called Anthony Murphy, and he says, I'm just sitting here reading his book. I tell you, they're the sort of synchronicities that have happened. As to whether they have any meaning or not, well, you can make up your own mind about it. For me, certainly the as I said, the mystical experience is definitely a part, I believe, a fundamental aspect of the creation of the monuments. There's a mystical and a mythical element to the whole thing that one has to be cognizant of, or one is not equipped, in my opinion, to reveal a fuller picture about what the purpose of the monuments might have been. That's not to get into a haughty sort of state of mind where, you know, I'm not one of these people who thinks I have all the answers. Far from it. In fact, I regularly say that in reality, and I'm in a traffic jam in Drogheda, this one of the advantages of getting out of town and into the valley is that you don't often meet traffic jams, and it's lovely, and you can just spend time out in the valley in the proximity of the monuments without all this stuff. But anyway, I've often said that, you know, I think that the day that we are able to answer all the questions will be a very sad day when it comes to exploration of Newgrange and Nowth and Dowth and all of the monuments and all of the myths. And in some ways, in fact, when you do appear to answer a question, you generally, in my experience, ask several more. That it's not a case of, well, I now know what this was all about, so it's fully solved and I don't need to think about it anymore. It's not like that at all. There's a wonderful continuity about it, I suppose. And as each new piece of the jigsaw appears to fall into place, it's almost like in some cases another piece falls away. Anyway, thank you very much to everybody who has followed and liked Mythical Ireland and interacted. You have to understand, this is still a hobby for me. It's not a job. I work full time in the newspaper industry, as I have done since I pretty much left school. Mythical Ireland and the books that I write and the photography and the videos and all the rest is a hobby and a passion and an interest. Okay, albeit a significant one. And who knows, maybe someday I'll be able to turn all this into a career. And that wouldn't that be lovely, because it would feel like I was never working. But to say to all of you who follow me on Facebook, who follow my blog on mythicalireland.com, who are subscribed on my YouTube channel, or who maybe watch my pictures on various sites like Instagram and Flickr, thank you very much for, you know, your lovely support. It's wonderful and it's greatly appreciated. I'm very indebted to you all for continuing to do that. It's interesting because people throw up questions, and there's always interesting discussions, especially on Facebook. There's always interesting discussions around the posts. You put up a picture or you say something in a blog and somebody says, you know, they either develop the theme that you're on or they argue with you. They say, oh, I don't think that's the case and here's what I think. And it's just all the time, it's constructive and it's fascinating. So I just wanted to say thank you. I'm going home now in the hope that when I get home, there are 30,000 likes on the page. I'll upload this video, but also I have a few photos that I've been keeping, a few very special photos that I've been keeping for this moment, in celebration of the milestone. So thanks again. And if there's ever anything that you want me to talk about in one of these videos, or something that you want me to blog about or write about on Facebook on Mythical Ireland, don't be afraid to ask. Send me a message on Mythical Ireland or send me an email. The email address is very easy to remember. It's mythicalireland@gmail.com. So once again, thanks everybody. And here's to, well, who knows, 50,000, 100,000. Could we dream about a million someday? You never know. Thanks again. All the best for now from Drogheda, from myself, from Anthony.